Hey, everybody, welcome to another week of The Good Word. I'm Pastor John, and this week I want to talk to you about the goodest of all the good words, and that is the word love. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. So, hey there. I'm glad you could take a few minutes out of your busy schedule to join me as we reflect on God's Word for a few minutes. I'm standing in the front of our church sanctuary here at First Congregational Church in Holden, and I'm standing in front of this window that we stare at every Sunday and every time we worship in here. And I don't know how much attention you've ever paid to this window. It's a very interesting artistic depiction, and I honestly don't know exactly what it all means. There's three people, whether they're angels or apostles or saints underneath. And then there's this big one up top, which I assume is Jesus. And he's ascending, and he has a tablet in his hand, and on his tablet it says the word love. Now, I'm not big into artistry and all this stuff, but I stare kind of blindly at this window every week. But the one thing about this window that is definitely true and about our Lord is that of all the things he said and of all the things that were written down, writing the word love on that tablet, whatever this artist decided, was a great decision, because there really is no greater word, no greater thing. I don't think it can be emphasized enough. If you're growing in your faith and growing as a Christian, if you're growing in your spiritual disciplines and growing in your knowledge of God, and you're coming to church regularly and being active, and you lose sight of the fact that love is the most important thing, you've really missed it all. Which brings me to a very familiar passage that is worth reading over and over from 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. Paul, speaking to the Corinthians about so many different things, says to them, "And now I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I am nothing." Think of all these great things you could do with your life or do for God. You could have a gift of prophecy. You could be a great teacher or preacher or just evangelist or somebody out there. You could be someone who is just incredibly smart and knowledgeable about the Bible and all of these things. You could be somebody who just has this incredible faith and this incredible courage, and they go out and do great things for God. You could have an incredible heart for the needy and for those who need help and care for the poor. But Paul is saying, of all these great things, if you lose sight of love, you've missed it all. Love is so important, my friends. I could pull out verse after verse after verse. And where does love begin? Love begins with the heart of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, right? We know that. That's in the Gospel of John 3:16. In later writings of John, in the Epistle of 1 John, John says, "We love because he first loved us." That's where it begins, my friends. The first thing you need to know is how much God loves you, and just how incredibly valuable to you are, and how wonderful and widely accepted you are by him. Let that sink in. Let that permeate you. And they're not just words that you psychologically have to train yourself with, though that's helpful, but God's Spirit will enter into you and just let you know that you're just loved. And make some space in your life, make some space in your heart just to soak that in. But don't stay there, because as God loves us, we are also to love others. Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, gave that great command. He said, "As I have loved you, so you also must love one another." And he washed the disciples' feet. He served them. He got down and dirty with them because he loved them so much. And the very next day, he was going to go to the cross and suffer greatly, not for anything that he needed to do for himself, but he did it for us out of love. And Jesus said, "Greater love has no one than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends." Jesus said over and over, right, the greatest command is to love God with all your heart and to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. And if you remain in me, my joy will remain in you. You will remain in me if you keep my commands. And my command is this from John 15, that you love one another. My friends, there is nothing more important than love. Now, love is more than just a heart that cries when you see someone in pain or a heart that just is broken for other people. It starts there. But God's love is a powerful thing. It's more than just emotions or warm feelings or warm fuzzies. It's love in action, right? It's that love like Jesus had that washed the disciples' feet, that went to the cross. And Paul goes on in 1 Corinthians to tell us what this love is like. Don't wimp out on love and think it's just some Hallmark lovey-dovey, warm and fuzzy thing. That's part of it, but that's not all of it at all. It's a tough, committed love. 1 Corinthians 13:4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. I won't unpack all of those in this brief little message, but think about that. Love is patient. Love is kind, doesn't envy, doesn't boast, not proud, not rude, not self-seeking, not easily angered, keeps no record of wrongs. Think about these things. I want to expound on each one, but you just think about it. You know what these things mean. Verse 8, love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. Think about that. Things will come and go, but love will never fail. Because in the end, because love is all about relationships, we will end up in the presence of God, in full relationship with Him, and He in full relationship with us. That's what this is all about. Love never fails. For now we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect will disappear. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. Now we're in a temporary state where we have churches, where we have all these rituals and stuff. But the ultimate goal is love, to be in God's love and relationship with Him and to be in relationship with one another forever. And these other things will pass away when the fullness comes. We're children now in terms of love and religion and our relationship with God. But the fullness of it is found in love. And so let's be careful that we don't get caught up in churchianity or in religiosity or even in our good work serving the poor or moving mountains because we have courageous faith. Let's not get caught up in all of that and lose sight of loving God and loving one another. Again, let your heart be broken. Let it be tender. Let it be emotional. Let it be moved to action. Because real love washes feet. Real love serves. Real love lays its life down and even goes to the cross. That's incredible love. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. Think about that. Boil it down to, we've got faith. If you've been in church recently, we've been talking about faith. Boy, it's so important in the Christian faith. We are saved by our faith. Abraham was saved by his faith. Everyone who comes to God is saved only by their faith, not by their good works, not by anything, but by faith. That's so important. And hope is so important. The Christian message brings hope. It brings hope that God has not abandoned us. God has not rejected us. God will not judge us or punish us or cast us out or send us to hell. God will accept us and God will walk with us and He'll fill us with His Spirit and God will bring us to eternal life. Think of that, how important hope is. Faith is foundational. Hope is so central to the Christian faith. And love. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these, hear this, is love. The greatest of these is love. And so, my friends, let's not lose sight of the importance of love, of all the things that are out there in the Christian faith, of hope, of service to others, of knowledge and growing and becoming disciples, of all these things, love is the most important. Let's never lose sight of it. And when you come to church here on Sunday, and you look at this picture, and you look carefully, and you see that Jesus is holding the word love in his hand in this artist's depiction, may that be a constant reminder and a constant central focus for us that love is the greatest of all. And that, of all the good words, is the goodest of all.